come this morning thanking you for our church family. We thank thee, O God, for our pastor and his family. And Master, we ask that you just look down and have mercy upon us. We ask, O God, that you just forgive us of all our sins and our shortcomings. And help us, O God, as we go through this life, Master. Lord, we come this morning realizing that you are a prayer hearing God. And realize, O Master, that you are a merciful God. We ask for mercy this morning, Master. Father, we ask you to look down upon us. Those that amongst us that might be sick this morning. Our bodies might be in pain. Father, we ask you just please look down and have mercy. Those that might be in bereavement this morning, Master, we ask your blessings upon them. We ask for comfort and strength, Lord. Help us to be a hand for them this morning, God. Master, we ask you to bless this deacon boy this morning, Master. Help us, O God, that we might be able to stand and be men for you, Master. Help us that we might not be ashamed of you, Father. Help us to lift you every day of our lives, Master. Help us to let our light shine in our homes, on our jobs, Master. That somebody might see Jesus in our lives and want to come to you this morning, Master. Father, we ask you to just please look down and have mercy upon us. Realize that, Father, all our strength comes from you and you alone, Master. And we need you this morning, Master. Father, we ask you just please have mercy upon us. Continue to bless this church. Father, we ask you to look amongst the congregation this morning. And if there is any need out there, Father, if it be thy will, just ask you your blessings upon it this morning. Father, we ask you to bless our children this morning, Master. Help us, O God, that we might be a light before them. We ask, O God, that you just bless your preached word here this morning. We pray, O God, that your word might have power, that somebody might be helped, Master. And then, Father, we ask you just bless our services through this day. We ask you to bless our services on this afternoon, Master. And we ask that your will might be done, Father. Oh, Lord, just please go with us and strengthen us through this day, Master. Lead us and guide us. Because, Father, we realize that one day that you're coming back for your church, Master. And we pray, oh God, that we'll be a part of that church. For it's in your name I pray this morning. Amen.
Praise to our God. we're so happy to have you here at Morningstar. We love everyone. When those doors are open and you come in, we have love. We have love for all. God is love, and we love you. So we're very happy to have you this morning, and we hope you get something out of the service. So please keep standing, because Morningstar, we want to go over and show love to our visitors at this time, please. Would you like to have something to say? Yes, would you like to have something to say, young lady? Oh, okay. Okay, good.
Y'all ready to clap your hands? Come on, get ready to clap your hands. Yeah. Are you ready, sopranos?
We thank you, oh Lord.
Uh-huh.
We magnify you.
Yeah.
We worship you, oh Lord.
Come on now.
We magnify your name.
Come on, let's praise him. Uh-huh. Come on, y'all.
We magnify your name.
We worship you.
We worship you, oh Lord.
Yeah.
We magnify your name.
Now everybody clap your hands. Come on, y'all, out there.
Clap your hands.
Uh-huh.
Everybody.
Yeah. Clap your
hands. Clap your hands.
Clap your hands.
Clap your hands.
Clap your hands.
Clap
your hands.
Come on.
We worship you,
O Lord.
Yeah. Come on now. Come on, clap your hands. The Bible say what? Sister Wade, clap your hands.
Clap your hands.
Clap your hands.
Clap your hands.
Spiritual stress test. and we see some results that we need to straighten out. Amen. Now, last week we dealt with blockages. Amen. I told you that if we don't take care of those blockages can't heal you. Amen. Amen. And so we're going to deal with another blockage here today. Amen. Turn with us to Mark chapter 10. Very familiar passage of scripture. It's coming from a new twist. Amen. Mark chapter 10, verse 21 and 22. Amen. It starts really at verse 17, but we're going to just, for your hearing pleasure, amen, we'll start at verse 21. Amen. We come from the King James Version of God's Holy Writing. You have another translation, that's quite all right. And wind up on the same road because it is the Word of God. Amen. Mark chapter 10, verse 21 and 22. Have it, say amen. If not, say wait for me. Amen. And it reads like this. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him, and said unto him, one thing thou lackest. Go thy way. Sell whatsoever thou hast, and give it to the poor, and thou shalt have treasures in heaven. And come, take up thy cross, and follow me. And he was sad at the saying, and went away grieved, for he had great possessions. May God have a blessing to the reading of his holy Word. Church checkup, heart problems, part two. Heart problems, part two. When we conducted the spiritual stress test, we found some blockages that could cause us to have certain symptoms. But we have found a more serious problem. And so as we look at our stress tests, we come to find that we have heart failure. Now the word heart failure can be misleading. The heart is a powerful muscle that pumps blood to the other organs of the body. But it hadn't stopped. It hadn't stopped working, y'all. All it means is that it cannot and does not fully support the body's need for blood and oxygen. Now, I want you to know that you're not alone in this thing. Nearly 6 million people are living with heart failure. But you might be asking me, what does heart failure look like? Now, each time the heart beats, it squeezes and it relaxes. Now, in a healthy heart, When it relaxes, it fills with blood. Then it squeezes and it pushes the blood, which contains nutrients and oxygen, out to the rest of the body. Now, in a heart that has heart failure, the heart is weakened and unable to pump enough blood throughout the body. Heart failure is an ongoing disease that gets worse over time. But the more we know about the disease, the more you can do to help manage this condition. But as we look at it spiritually, what causes heart failure in the church? Now that's one word with five letters. Money. Government leaders, businesses, families, even churches get trapped into thinking that money is the answer to every problem. Yes, when we have problems, we throw money at our problem. But just as the thrill of wine is only temporary, the soothing effect of the last purchase soon wears off, and you have to buy some more. Amen. Don't y'all look at me like that. Amen. Amen. We all ain't been saints all our life. Amen. Amen. But Scripture recognizes that money is necessary for survival. But the warning is against the love of money. Amen. Money is dangerous because it deceives us into thinking that wealth is the easy way to getting everything that we want. Amen. But the love of money is sinful because we trust the money rather than God to solve our problems. Amen. There ain't one in the White House right now. Amen. They think money can solve the problem. Amen. But the problem is he can't keep his mouth shut. And he can't stop his thumb from tweeting. Amen. But we got the same problem in the church. Amen. We think that money is our God. Amen. Amen. We think money is the thing that we need most of all. But we done forgot about God. Amen. Amen. We trust that the money can take care of the problem, but we leave God in the trunk until we all out of flex. Those who pursue its empty promises will one day discover that they have nothing because they are spiritually bankrupt. As Scripture would say, for where the money of the church goes, so goes the heart. Indeed, you can see the predictable patterns beginning to emerge in the budgets of churches. When Willington R. Burt, when he died in 1919, he was known as one of the wealthiest people in America. He had amassed a fortune as a lumber baron. And some estimate, yes, his wealth between $40 to $90 million. He was the number 8 among America's richest persons. He also was a political power and served as mayor of Saginaw, Michigan, as well as a state senator for Michigan. But I want you to know that Mr. Burt was greedy. Matter of fact, he was very greedy. His will was a perfect reflection of his greed. He stated that no one could receive a dollar of his estate until 21 years after the death of his last surviving grandchild. In other words, he didn't want the family that he knew to get any of his money. Many tried, but the courts held up the rights of his greedy will and life. But in 2011, distributions were finally made to a dozen relatives Bert never knew, 92 years after his death. Now, I never met a member of a church who thought his or her church was greedy, or thought their greed compared to such a miserable hermit as Wellington or Bert. And I'm not sure if greed is the descriptor of these churches. Perhaps I would better say that their funds were inward focused. Don't get me wrong, y'all. In a vibrant church, the staff often meets the needs of the members. Like a healthy heart, the money flows and are disputed and distributed, yeah, freely through every ministry. But not in these churches that try to have an iron grip and a tight-fisted way of spending. And today, I believe that if we look at our text has been heard, preached, read, and even taught. We all know that one day a wealthy man appeared to Jesus and asked him, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" Now Jesus, he started with some Ten Commandments. And in a way, the young man begins to stick his chest out. He begins, in so many words, to pat himself on the back. If you look at Scripture, he says, "I've done those things from my youth till now." Yes, Jesus, as he started with the Ten Commandments, then he lovingly breaks through the young man's pride with a challenge that answered his question. This challenge exposed the barrier that could keep this young man out of the kingdom: his love for money. Yes, Jesus loved him. After he answered that question, Jesus loved him and said to him, "You lack one thing. Go, sell all you have and give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." Hey. But he was stunned at this demand. Yes, and he went away grieved because he had many possessions. Did y'all get that? The man couldn't let go. The text says he grieved at the thought of giving up his possession. The man's wealth made his life comfortable and gave him power and prestige. When Jesus told him to sell everything he owned, Jesus was touching the very basis of the man's security and identity. Yeah, he couldn't meet the one requirement that Jesus gave to him: to turn his whole heart and his life over to God. Yes, he deemed the price too high, and he went sadly away. Yes, and you know what? He was possessed by his possession. And it's bad when we're possessed by our possession because we can't see anything else but what we're looking at.
Let me be free, trusting you.